From the all-new Fatheadz Studios in Speedway, Indiana, this is The Skinny with the founder and CEO of Fatheadz Eyewear, Rico Elmore.
All right, here we are today again at the Fatheadz Studios. Sean Buckley.
We're here.
Chris Wheeler.
Present.
Again. So, tell us what you've been up to. I see you're wearing a Robert Wickens hat. What's the update? Anything?
Yeah, I mean, obviously the team came out with an update the other day. Said he was off the breathing apparatus, which is good. You know, I think there's a lot of indeterminate things is what they're saying. It's going to take time until he's, you know, fully alert and really lucid and know kind of the effects of the injury. You know, hopefully, I mean, I got to tell you, the Schmidt-Peterson guys and his family, IndyCar, they've done a good job of keeping us updated when they could, reducing the rumors, you know, doing that sort of stuff. But it's really neat this past weekend at St. Louis to see all of the other crew guys, drivers, various teams, all, you know, with the Robert Wickens apparel on. But, he's a special guy.
Yeah.
You know, he showed up as one of our athletes from Europe DTM, and the kid changed how we do business even at Bell, and how, you know, what some of the details we look at. And he's just talented. And he's
seems
nice.
Like a great guy. I never met him.
Yeah,
never met him. Don't know him.
You can't ask for somebody who's going to push you more.
Yeah,
right. And from every aspect. I mean, from the guy that cleans the shop up at Schmidt-Peterson, to each mechanic, the truck drivers, the engineers, the sponsors, you know, he gives you 110% at all times, and he's going to expect you to match him. And it can be a pain in the ass.
Yeah, it
can suck.
Sure.
But when you look at it, all you can really do is respect it. Because
that's awesome.
He changes the vibe. He gives hope. And now we're just hoping and praying that he makes a full recovery and we get to see him get back in. Because the big question with him and his IndyCar career is not a matter of if he's going to be a race winner or a champion. It was just when.
When.
I mean, sure. The kid is that good.
Sure. So I watched him at St. Pete. Was it last year? Was his first year?
It was this year. It was this year.
Yeah. Okay. So I'm losing track. But I watched him at St. Pete, and the dude was amazing. And I mean, I loved the interview with him that said, yeah, this is the first time I ever saw this track.
Yeah.
You know, he had no clue, never been on it. And
he dominated that day, and then
and got pancaked.
Yeah, he and Rossi touched, and then my boss slid right through and said, hey, 2 years in a row, I'll start last and win.
I don't know about touched. I think that's a nice way of putting it. So
he got drove through.
He got drove through pancake style into one there, I think it was, right?
Well, didn't Schumann spot for him at the Speedway?
Yeah, so Schumann actually did some pickup stuff this year. Schmidt-Peterson had some guys that were rotating on their spotters because it's a long month, right? And it's hard for a group of guys to be able to just cancel their life for a month if they're not full-time.
They're no Chris Wheeler. Okay.
Well, hey, let's
bring that out right now.
You know, but it was great for Schumann to be able to get up there. He did the hat dance, you know, and he was with Wickens for a couple of days, Hinch for a couple of days, Harvey for a couple of days, I think Jay Howard for a couple of days.
Oh, okay. I didn't know that.
But he spent majority of his time on the six machine there, and he enjoyed it.
That's cool. You know, a lot of people don't understand how important that job is, really.
Yeah.
Less than a Wheeler.
Yeah, you know.
They don't. But
I mean, I don't want to tell everybody how awesome it is. I have enough people trying to take my job.
listen, I was at the Speedway many years ago and was listening to the radio, and Tiago Medeiros was driving, and we maybe talked about this on the podcast you and I did together. And Tiago was driving, and he's hauling it down into one. It's Saturday. That's when bump day was Sunday, you know, and it was so there were 34 cars there, and his spotter, we'll just say his name was Bob, and his spotter keyed the mic up as he's going into one, wide open, keys the mic up and says, "Cut," and it spooked him.
The next thing you heard was, boom.
No.
It spooked him, and he yanked the car down below the line, upset the car, and, I mean, nailed the wall, destroyed it. I mean, the whole thing.
So I had worked for that program earlier in the month, just helping them for Thiago's rookie orientation. And I got him through his ROP phases, and the other character, Bob, was there listening. He wanted to learn. He was going to learn everything.
You were a bad teacher. That's all I can tell you.
He thought he could learn everything he needed to know during one ROP session. And
don't key the mic up.
Unless you got something to say, just sit there.
And don't feel like you have to say something.
Yeah, no.
Just shut up.
No, I'd like to say at St. Louis, there was a lot of time where I didn't speak. But, well, there was, because we crashed in the first corner, the first lap. I was at the Indiana State line by the time the checker came out. But Pocono, there was 15, 20 lap stints where I didn't have to say a word. I mean, we were so spread out. I mean, hey, that guy's in the car. He's doing his thing, right?
Right.
I'll talk to the crew channel on a different loop, you know, and I know what adjustments he's making inside the cockpit. And I know everything he's got going on. I know where we're at with fuel mileage, but there's no sense in bothering him. He's out there running 230 plus down the straightaways at Pocono, you know, with his sphincter clenched every time he turns into turn one.
I spotted for Damian Gardner at Iowa in the sprint car.
Oh,
that was fun. That was actually a good time. Once we got the mics dialed in, like for practice and the heat race, whatever, all you hear is the motor. I'm like, we need to hear you, not the Mopar.
Yeah, right.
So finally come feature time. And it was actually a really cool thing to be on top of the grandstands and be able to talk to the driver and be like, hey, dude, someone spilled oil. It's not yellow. Go low. Just stay low. Stay low. It's like a cool feeling of, you know, kind of feeling like you're keeping all the trains moving on time up there.
Almost like the cool feeling when I climbed out on the roof with you at Eldora.
Yeah.
Such a bad idea. He's out there filming, and I'm like, I'll just go out there with him. Nobody stops me. I'm like,
ugh. Yeah, it's sketchy out there.
Yeah, St. Louis was a short one. Here's my entire night.
Yeah.
Get ready. Green, 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 green. Outside. They're charging up the bottom behind. Still outside. Oh, ooh. You okay? Yellow's us, boys.
Easy money.
Turn the radio off and walk on down.
Do you have a golf cart or a little mini bike or anything?
It depends on the track.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What's your setup? You have to go out and around or just cross at the front stretch?
There's a tunnel there in turn four. A lot of times for the race, I'll just walk right across and cross the flag stand and up. But see, St. Louis doesn't have an elevator.
Or air conditioning. Yeah. I heard she was a soggy hot one there.
Yeah. Yeah. The first day, Friday? Hot. Friday, I was freezing, right? Because we had rain come through and a cold front. And I was wearing pants and hoodie. Like, I was cold at night. And then yesterday? Saturday.
Yeah.
Oof.
It's 2 days ago.
Yeah, Saturday. Brutal. Saturday. I'm glad I had my Fatheadz iPhone fan. I can tell you that. People were like, why are you staring at your phone so high? I'm like, I'm using my fan.
Yeah.
Compliments to the fine folks of Fatheadz.
I'm fanning myself a bit.
Dude, we were out at Garrett's go-kart track yesterday, a little dirt oval in his backyard.
Did he just build that?
Mm-mm. It's been around a couple years.
Oh, okay.
But there's
I saw something on Facebook. Somebody else was doing one similar.
Oh, Wingo. Jimmy Wingo.
Wingo, that's
it. Yeah. I was wondering where that is. That's got to be somewhere around here.
Yeah.
But, dude, it was hot yesterday. Like, it was a little over 100 degrees, and the humidity was right around 80%. And everybody's like, it's really not that bad out here. I go, sure. You're sitting in the shade. Yeah. My dad's like, it's really not that bad out here. I go, dude, go walk out in that infield where there's no shade for about 15 minutes. Dude. You're going to want to hit the AC quick. I'm over here sweating.
Well, yesterday when I walked out to the tip, it was toasty.
Yeah.
I was like, well.
But I got another question. I'm still stuck on this. Your transportation mode back from the spotting stand. Have you ever considered the shoes with roller skates in them?
Well, climbing the steps might become a little difficult.
They retract. I've seen the kids in the stores.
Are they Skechers? Who makes those things?
I don't think.
You don't think don't they think got I, one they'll fit?
Yeah. No, with the heel rollers?
The Heelys? Heelys, is that what they're called?
Yeah. That'd be a bad idea, semi
RC. You know,
size.
I used to have a day, like back in my day. I used to have my own scooter with my name on it. You know, like it was always filled with gas and clean, and that was great. Those are the days. The market today in the spotter game is not as strong as
Dude,
it used to be.
I got this. I have it figured out.
All right.
Have you ever seen the Super 73? Either you haven't.
Is that the Sam's Club?
No. It's a new bicycle that this company made, and it looks like an old Honda Mini Trail motorcycle. The frame, the style of it, with the big seat pad. It's an electric retro looking bicycle called the Super 73.
Hmm.
And as soon as you guys see him in action, to be like, order two now.
Dude, the world's largest men were on one of those Honda 70s. Remember that in the Guinness book? Oh, they're like riding.
Well, Honda's coming out with a new one. It's called the Monkey. So it's got the, it looks like an old Trail 90, but it has like all the internals of the Grom, the Honda Groms. So it's got some kick to it. It's got some really good functionality, but it looks like an old vintage bike.
Mm-hmm.
And so when the boss man saw that, he's like, oh, I think Bell needs one of these for the Sprinter van. I'm like, hey, I agree.
Yeah, you're going to start seeing the Super 73s at a dirt track near you.
I think I need to get a Fathead Super 73 for the spotter stand. I mean, the official's...
Well, I've got a Zuma.
The official eyewear.
What's that?
The Zuma?
Yeah.
It used to be DUI Dance.
DUI Dance? What's a Zuma?
Besides it's a scooter.
The scooter.
The drunk scooter. The DUI scooter.
Really?
Yeah, the liquor sickle.
I don't think I've seen
No shifting.
Electric bike or electric scooter?
It's a scooter.
It's like the one Schumann runs around town on.
Do you stand or scooter? Sit?
You sit.
Sit.
Nice.
It's just like...
And ours is carbon fiber black.
Oh.
The Zuma? Yeah.
It's one of those things that you see every DUI victim between here and the former Fathead studio.
I know what it is. Yeah, it's a...
But here's the thing. That bunch, they've got a liquor sickle sales place over there that's got the knockoffs.
Yeah.
The Zumas are north side. They're pretty high class.
Yeah, it's the north side item.
It's the people with them high paying jobs that...
Yeah, not the Yamoto, which is our version over here on our side of town.
I think I've seen the Zuma. It's like a it looks like a Vespa. It's just a scooter. It's like a scooter. Yeah. The guy that restored the Hoosier.
I'm definitely not classy enough to have a Vespa.
Vespa.
Nor do I wear a man bag or a vest.
We saw a group of Vespa riders as we were walking leaving the football game the other day. There was 20 grown men on Vespas.
Yeah. Yeah, they've got a scarves. Gang.
Full scarves.
Scarves.
Full open face.
I wonder if they have their own tribal tattoo.
They got a lot of things going on. I don't know where they were going.
Tribal tattoo. That's really strange. Real weird.
The old Vespa tribe.
Yeah.
Coming from the suburbs near you soon.
We had a good weekend. We went to a concert. Was that Friday night? What night was that?
Thursday night.
We went and saw. Now, I never heard of this band. But they're called Government Mule. I've heard of the Allman Brothers, and the lead singer and guitar player for Government Mule was in the Allman Brothers, right?
Right.
And
right.
This guy rips. And so I'm like, okay, we'll go. You know, Enrico's really into music. I'm into music. So we piled up in the old SUV.
Went skipping along, holding hands on our way there.
We did.
Beautiful.
And it was. It was fun. Good music. A huge turnout.
I was amazed how many people were there.
Same here.
I didn't.
Where was it?
Deer Creek Variety.
I'm sorry, Ruoff.
Yeah, it's Deer Creek. Clutch. It'll always be Deer.
Yeah.
It'll always be Deer Creek.
Easy for you to say.
Yeah, now it's called Ruoff. The Ruoff Home
what
Mortgage.
What were you called when we were out there waiting? We waited. We didn't go in and watch one act before it all started.
We were pre-gaming it. And the cool thing about Deer Creek is that they have like the bar area, the VIP section, you know, Rico, how he does it. You know, we got to go in style. So they have, you get into the VIP area and they have this covered bar area with the bathrooms and, you know, everybody's hanging out. Then they have a little lounge area that's outdoor. And dude, it's a nice setup. Never been. I mean, it was a really killer setup. But yeah, we pre-gained it for a couple hours. And
they had buy one, get one free tickets at Kroger. That's why we went in there.
Right next where the girls selling the Thin Mints.
Very nice. Thin Mints. So,
got about six boxes in the freezer now.
Yeah, how much are the boxes, hon? They're $9. Okay, well, how many are 10 boxes? 90 bucks. Okay, here's 100. I'm good. I did that once at the old Marsh in Brownsburg. I purposely, as soon as I walk in, she's like, okay, Mom, it's the big guy. I know I'm going to make a bunch of money. And I straight stone cold her. I'm just like straight faced, never even pay attention. Excuse me, sir. I'm just like, no. And her mom's there. So I purposely had some real shopping to do. So I went and got my goodies. And then on the way back, I hit her up and I said, you got any Thin Mints? She goes, oh, we got all kinds. We got peanut butter and chocolate. Give me six boxes. How much are they? They're $9. How much money is that? She goes, she's like 7 years old. She goes, $54. I go, here's 60. Keep the change. And her mother was like, thank you. Here's my number. Like, I do. Is there a Mrs.? Is there a Mr.? Miss, you know what I'm saying? Like, it was pretty funny. And her
mister's on vacation.
Yeah, it's like
the Forrest Gump line. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. My daddy's on vacation.
Is there a Mr. Gump?
All you got to do in this vacation. World. Yeah. All you got to do in this world is just be nice to the kids, buy some Girl Scout cookies.
Your mama sure does care about your education, son.
Exactly.
But here's my real question. You're floating this notion that you're nice to kids and loving and caring about them.
Sometimes.
And you floored the kid at Kansas City.
Oh, right, right.
What? Floored him.
Yeah. We scared him half to death. You seen the goats where you scare the goats and they just fall over? Same deal. We're walking through. This is back when the Jack Slash thing was running hotter than a pistol. So I had always carried a bunch of stickers on me. So I had a big old fat thing of stickers. And him and I are walking through one of the halls, one of the corridors at the Kemp Arena in Kansas City for the midget race.
Anybody ever get paid for that, by the way?
I don't know. I certainly didn't. But the memories will last
about.
Oh, but the memories will last a lifetime.
Yeah.
So about
the room service thing, we can talk about that.
Oh later. Yeah, we got them stacking up. We got stories backing up like the 405. But yeah, we walk by this kid and the parent, and I go, "Hey, kid, you want a sticker?" And this kid dropped like a
locks billy goat. Up like this.
It's folds.
Folds.
I mean,
I look at Sean. I'm like, "Just what you do to the kid?"
Was that the same trip where it was too late to order food, and we figured out a place that did order late night food, and we spent about $9,000 pizza, mozzarella sticks, jalapeno poppers, and him and I are laying on different beds. We have to, in our underwears.
Which was very attractive.
But there's ranch everywhere. There's sauce. There's, dude, it's a mess.
Dude, we've got it about 35 degrees in there, too.
Oh, it's cranked.
Meat locker.
Both of those are laid out. Well, So the whole room service thing, we couldn't get them to bring the food up there. We're like standing at the Crown Plaza or something there, you know. So we want them to bring the food up, and the guy says, "Sir, you're going to need to come downstairs to the front desk and get this food. We do not let delivery people bring food up." I said, "Let me tell you this. I have two very young children that are sleeping right now, and I cannot leave the room."
Yeah, we have to tend to our children.
We have to tend to our children.
We can't leave them unattended. Hey,
guess what? They brought it up.
Yes, they did. And it was pretty good food, too.
It's pretty great. With customer service now, you just put them in a culturally
awkward
position, and they're going to do whatever you ask them to do. You're because like, they're so scared you're going to get on Twitter and talk about how terrible the customer service
this
was.
This is before any of that stuff was around either, though.
Yeah, that was kind of that was pre all the social media. The crazy thing about that Kemp Arena deal was, besides it being super cold, but it was the place where the WWF wrestler Owen Hart fell.
Yeah.
And I'm standing
to
there.
To his death.
Yes, to his death. He hit the turnbuckle. And I remember looking up all the way up there to the very top of the rafters where he fell. And it is a long way up there.
Oh, yeah.
Long way up. It's hard to not think about it when you go there. But interesting, though. I think that was the night where we were doing the live radio and Rico was there. We all went. It was a good time. But I remember Shane Meal and Jimmy Light starting in the back row. And this track was about as big as this room. It made DeCoin look like Indy.
Yeah.
I mean, it was little. Horrible. But Light and Shane Meal, they started in the back row, and they took two out of the last chance race, and they took the two spots, transfer spots, from last on this little itty-bitty track. That was also the night where Rico was a big fan of the guy doing the national anthem with the solo, with Jimi Hendrix style. This guy comes out there, ladies and gentlemen, he's a local sensation. You can find him in any bar locally here in Kansas City, guitar playing, Ralph, whatever. Ralph, take it away.
That's way too good. This guy was butchering the most beautiful song in the world, and I had had enough. I mean, to the point where I'm now yelling out of the stands to stop it. And that's not me.
He had the diamond plate guitar.
Yeah.
Diamond plate.
Yeah. Oh, that's right. It was diamond plate. It was very glary.
Hey, yeah, just very so you know, eerie. I have a video I can show you guys later. Last week at Pocono, 2 weeks ago, whenever that was.
Yeah.
Lee Greenwood.
No. Live in person.
Guess what? Who cares? I saw him at Bristol.
Wow. He's on the
tour. He's on the tour.
God,
circle track.
Tim Duggar and Lee Greenwood.
So right. Did he do? Yeah, exactly. So Greenwood, did he do God Bless the USA?
Oh, yeah.
We're the land of Minnesota.
Yeah, so he did that first, and then we did a couple other things, and we did, you know, we said a prayer, we had the color guard. Then he got up there, and he rocked, and I'm just like, oh, this man.
Did you get the goosebumps?
Dude, I got to tell,
every time.
Total chills. I got to tell you something. One thing about NASCAR, especially in the South, the fans are the most patriotic, unbelievable, awesome people on earth, right?
Oh, yeah.
So we're at Bristol. They start out with him singing, right? If that doesn't get you going, you know, I mean, you know, you're just not American if you don't think that. But anyhow.
Communist.
Anyhow, so gets it going with that. And then They do a Pledge of Allegiance.
Oh, yeah.
Wow, classroom style.
Pledge of Allegiance, not one person sitting. And then they roll right into the national anthem with, you know, these little kids that are as cute as all get out. And I'm telling you, I was just, I watched it two nights in a row, and I sat there. And I mean, listen, we have great fans at Indy, too, and at IndyCar races, as far as that goes. But, I mean, it was awesome. I mean, it was unbelievable. I was like, Pledge of Allegiance? I've been to that race a lot of times, and I just don't think I remembered that taking place. So, but it was, yeah. How about that? He's on tour.
I'm digging it.
Yeah.
Tim Duggar. I've heard this name before. Country recording, Nashville recording artist.
Nashville recording artist, Timothy Duggar.
National recording artist, or just Nashville. Is it national or national?
I think it's Nashville.
Where does he perform?
I don't think so.
I've seen his name.
He does a bunch of stuff. So he travels. He does a lot of cup races. He does. They bring him in to do, like, the night before parties in the big campgrounds. Mm. He did after the A-Main at Knoxville. He went on at 1:40 in the morning in the pig barn at Knoxville Raceway.
Oh, wow.
It's like the Charlie Daniels band. On the free stage, here in the course free stage, we got the Charlie Daniels band.
And then Brad Sweet got up there and sang Friends in Low Places after winning Knoxville Nationals.
Oh, dang.
Oh, yeah.
Nice.
Oh, yeah. He got jiggy with it.
How about Ted Nugent on the free stage at Barbecue Fest?
Yeah. He was at the Iowa IndyCar race.
Was he?
Uncle Ted. Uncle Ted was the Friday night show.
The Motor City Madman.
Sorry, the Saturday night show, because we were in there on Sunday, and I had to miss it because I went to the local Knoxville show. But, hey, you got to get spicy chicken bites whenever you can get spicy chicken bites.
Do you dunk them in anything?
Ketchup.
That's kind of like getting bojangled up when you go down to Bristol.
A Bowberry sandwich.
You will not find a better biscuit. Buttermilk biscuit than that place. I came home from Charlotte.
The Bojangles.
Oh, my God. I drove home from Charlotte. And I needed something, not a big heavy meal, but I look over, I go, Bojangles, what is that? Chicken and biscuits. I go, biscuits? Turn it around.
Dude, it makes Popeyes taste like frozen food.
I'm telling you.
And I have been Bojangled up before, but I didn't know if it was Bojangles or the fifth of bourbon the night before, but one of them got me.
Best buttermilk biscuit ever.
Dude, the Bowberry.
What is that?
So it's like a blueberry biscuit, but it's called the Bowberry biscuit.
Oh, yeah. It melts in your mouth.
Dude. It's absolutely just soaked in butter.
I'm ready, like right now.
These, I ordered four buttermilk fluffy biscuits and a Mountain Dew. This was a couple of 3 years ago.
Mountain Dew.
Dude, I was wired for
sound.
Yeah,
but let's be honest. The best food during race event was, where were we? Ocala, Florida? And we hit Rally's Checkers at like...
Yeah, it's the Florida version of Rally's. They call it Checkers.
We hit that thing three nights in a row after Ocala.
Such a bad idea.
You couldn't pull us off that place. No. I mean, we were locked in.
Like, dude, we're sitting there under a red flag in the feature like, man, I wish I'd hurry this thing up. I want some Checkers. Like,
they have the crunchy fries with the goodies.
Chocolate shake, and you dip the fry in the shake.
The burgers are tasty. Duh. I mean, they had the mozzarella sticks were
it
off the hook.
It was a tasty burger.
It was, man. Rico and I drove from all the way from Ocala to here in the old Scion, shoulder to shoulder.
Shoulder to shoulder.
You know what they have in Champaign where our corporate headquarters are, right? They have a legit Wiener Schnitzel.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
We used to hit that up. There's one in Ventura. We used to hit it every time.
I love the Wiener Schnitzel.
So let me ask you something. Have you seen this Devour Indy thing?
Oh, yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So do you remember it years back when you were living here full time? Years back. Like, it had, like, St. Elmo's on it. It had...
Like, the trucks. They all get the
trucks. No.
Oh, different deal.
No. No, this is where you can go to, like, St. Elmo's, and they have a certain menu.
A special menu for half price.
For a great price, right? Okay. Just try to get people out to try the stuff, right? So you've got the, Ruth, Chris, and all this and that. So last night, Una's sitting there. She's reading this stuff off to me. She goes, what? I'm like, why? She goes, what the hell is this? I said, what are you talking about? She goes, McDonald's is on this thing now.
Oh, yeah.
Steak and Shake. I mean, they've opened the gates.
They've opened the floodgates. They ruined it.
What the hell is
that? And what they've done is, the first couple of years, and it was Devour, they would have, like you said, a special kind of side hustle menu. And I was like, this is what you got. Boom, boom, boom. Well, that only works in certain restaurants or locations, but it was great for the ones that did it. It was awesome.
Dude, we always went to that.
But then, like, see, I'm a big fan of Fogo.
Yeah,
I'd like to go to Fogo once a month.
Yeah,
I don't pay attention to these.
So let me ask you something: the salad,
I don't need it. I don't have no idea.
Okay, all right, all right.
I don't need anything.
Have you been to Fogo before?
I do the salad. I also do about 9 million of the cheese balls.
Oh, see, that's
and
it.
And the crusted pepper
dude,
pork.
I'd pay the full price just for the cheese dude, balls.
So I take it next level. So I do salad. I actually like the salad.
The salad, you can get salad anywhere.
Yeah.
You're not paying for the salad. Well, that's the filler. They're betting on
that's
you
like
losing.
A, that is like the girl with the stuffed bra at the bar.
Mm.
Yeah, see?
Well, the thing is, there's you eat so much meat, though, you got to have a salad to kind of make
sure.
No,
you don't.
You don't.
No.
What's your favorite thing there? I do the pepper. The Parmesan crusted pork.
I do like it's the house special. It's the bottom loin type deal, medium rare, super thin.
It's a good place.
Yeah, the ass.
He's eating the ass.
Hey, 2018, bud. It's ass eating season.
That's funny because you said devour Indy. I thought you said deflower Indy.
Well, so but here's the problem. Here's the problem. So I'm a big fan of Fogo.
He's married now.
I'd go there. I'd go there once a month just to go. Right. I don't care about specials.
He's taken.
I don't care about discounts. I'm not a couponer. So look, if I want something, I'm just going to go get it, and I don't care.
But are you a couponer?
I'm an extreme couponer.
Couponer.
And so...
But listen, I'm with you, and I mean, it's not taking anything away from it, because I know people that are crazy coupons, right?
Oh, yeah.
My dad was one of them, all right?
My wife does it.
We used to be at the checkout at Cub Foods, so this is dating in a bit.
Cub Foods.
Yes. We were at the checkout at Cub Foods. 35 minutes later, after he's went through his three-ring binder, we have saved a significant amount of money, which it was a lot of money.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
I mean, it was unbelievable. But so anyhow, I'm like, I just want to go. I hope that nobody's there.
Like, dude, I went to Fogo once on accident during Devour, and apparently they have a whole Devour thing. The service was down, the quality of the food, everything was down, and I was like, some kid over here is in sweatpants with his butt crack hanging out. Like,
no, that's what I'm talking
like, see,
about.
Like,
check the riff.
Like, dude, I'm downtown. I put a collar on. I wore a classy Dodgers hat, not an average, but a class. I think
so
probably
you
black
got one
and black.
Of the clean ones out.
Yeah, yeah.
Would you wear a suit? Would you dress up to Fazoli's?
To Fazoli's?
Yeah.
No, I would not dress up to go to Fazoli's.
So this dates years back, right? So Jim Mills, did you ever know Jim?
No.
Owned Turbans Inc. He still does. He's a wild man. I mean, this dude was a Vietnam helicopter pilot. Crazy dude, right? He's been very successful with his business, done unbelievable, but he's crazy. I mean, he's just nuts how he acts. So the guys from Lucas Oil Raceway go out because they want to talk to him about doing another sponsorship deal and buying the suite and the billboards and all that stuff, right? So they get out there and he knows they're coming and it's later in the day and, you know, they were bringing him, they're going to take him to dinner. And they talk for a while and they said, well, what do you think? You ready for dinner? You ready to go grab something to eat? He goes, absolutely. He goes, I know this unbelievable Italian place. They're like, okay, lead the way. He pulls into Fazoli's.
Make sure you dress up. Wear something nice. Fazoli's.
Awesome.
Red sticks.
But guess what? Knowing him, he probably did it on purpose. He probably did it on purpose just jacking with him, you know. But
that's phenomenal.
Yes, yes, absolutely. So, what's your cue cards? I see you got some.
You got some cards? Here, we can bust some stuff out here. We'll have to bust some stuff out.
Hey, real quick, before we get going, though, I got to tell you, man, this is awesome.
Yeah.
Right? So, yeah, we were working on the Bell moving to Speedway thing about the same time that you had this whole, hey, Fatheadz needs to go culture, you know, back over into Speedway out of Indianapolis, technically.
Right, right.
We talked about it a lot. And then you said you acquired a new location, and I laughed, and I thought there's no way. And then I came over here at like day 7. And then I came over, you know, day 21.
Yeah.
All these times, and man, you guys have really blown it out. So,
and you had your hazmat suit on.
Oh, yeah. I'm still not breathing right.
Up to about 2 months ago.
But I got to tell you, you guys killed it. This is phenomenal. So I'm pumped.
And you know what? What you guys did with that place, I never even knew it was there. So that's a good start.
And yeah, we're getting there.
I guess you're working on something.
Always working on something bigger and better, right?
Right, right.
You got to keep digging.
But, it's, you know what, there's a lot of things that we did in this building that we just, you know, someone said the Taj Mahal, it's like, that's never what we were intending. What we were intending was a very comfortable atmosphere, a place that our, you know, our team can come to enjoy it, appreciate it, respect it,
yeah,
you know, and all that. So I mean, it's amazing to see the transformation of the staff, of how much they love it. And I mean, you know, it's like this our new podcast studio, you know, it's really cool, because you know what, we could pop in here, we can knock it out. Eventually it'll be able to go live feed.
Like right now, people don't know. People don't know if it's lunchtime. They don't know if it's 4 in the morning. We just got back from the bar. They have no idea.
I think they'd have a general idea if we just got back from the bar, Chris.
All right, so here's what we're going to do. We're going to lay out, while Buck's in town, three different times of day that we've got to come in and do this.
Ooh, I like this.
And we're going to let the fans at home determine which is which time zone.
I like this.
Hey,
luckily we're not, was it, overseen by the FCC?
Oh, no, dude, it's the internet. We can do anything.
Are you going to pick them, or are we going to do blind draws again?
Well, so earlier, we were here yesterday checking out the studio and everything, and if you walk down the Fatheadz Wall of Fame.
Oh, the one I'm not on, yeah.
Well, I mean, there's pictures, there's all sorts of fun stuff, but there's actually one of his old reporter
cards. Carl, don't add him either. Thank you.
There's one of these, one of his old report cards the wall.
So listen, here's the thing. I tell my mom, or my mom says, I found some of your school papers, you know, and I'm like, oh, okay, you know, whatever. So she's like showing me this stuff, and she says, and here's one of your report cards. And I'm thinking, oh my God, there's never been a good one of those, right? So she hands it to me. I'm saying it's from fourth or fifth grade. The only thing that really, you know, gets me going is whoever it was that wrote these things about me did not sign their name. Okay, so let's get that laid out first. So it says the first, or it says absences 0, tardies 3. Now keep in mind, I'm not driving at the age of fourth or fifth grade. So
if you're tardy, it's because whoever took you to school was tardy.
Right? Why are they blaming me? It's not my fault.
You're at the mercy of the Newcastle, Indiana school bus system,
or mom.
Mom, dad.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Yeah, and really, I was probably the reason why I was late, so I deserved it, but anyhow.
But regardless.
Regardless. You know, so anyhow, then it goes on to say, first semester, written grade, D plus, I think, right? Was it D plus? I can't remember the ways. It was good, though. It was passing.
D with potential.
Yes, D with potential. So then I had my attitude grade was an F. And down at the
bottom. For fun?
Down at the bottom. And then it averaged out to a D minus or something. Rascals. But anyhow, so gets down to the bottom and it says, Eric, my legal name, Eric would do so much better, but his mouth and attitude don't help. So all I'm thinking to myself is, why didn't you sign your name?
Yeah.
What, you tough guy? You don't have to sign your name to this stuff now?
We should go back.
I'm thinking about it. I'm going to get some hand samples, some handwriting samples.
Get the FBI?
Probably.
At that time, in fifth grade, what did you want to be when you grew up, though? I mean, what was on the radar?
Fifth grade.
Still in the fireman phase?
No, I think I want to be the guy that the fireman had to follow and clean. No, I'm kidding. I don't know. You know, I mean, forever. Hell, I don't think I even knew what I wanted to be. Maybe that was the funnest part of it. You know, I worked for my dad forever. You know,
what kind of work?
General contractor.
Oh, okay.
So, learn about every life skill you can learn from that man. You know, and. I said school was part of it, but you know, at the end of the day, that dude taught me everything. So, but you know, it's great to have dreams. And I have a dream when I was graduating high school that I was gonna, man, I'm gonna have an eyewear company. We're gonna service people all over the world. No, you know, did I say that I want to be this, want to be that? Whatever I said I wanted to be didn't work out, okay, to start with, all right? But that's the fun part about life. It's a path, right? Oh. And you know, it's, you know, it's, I mean, I met Wheeler, the way I meet Wheeler is 10 plus years ago, I would assume. Is that around the...
Oh, for sure.
10 plus years ago, and he's hustling sublimated shirts and race suits. And I'm like...
Speedracewear.com. Yeah. It's no longer available, but...
Yeah.
Was that the one right across the street from the old Brownsburg office?
From the Frameworks Marketing World Headquarters.
That's all right. So we were doing a lot of stuff for different drivers and this and that, and... They had the most unreasonable price in town, so we stuck with them.
We never made any money.
Never made any money, and Chris could never really tell you when anything was going to be ready either. So
whose business was that?
It was me, right? So I left my former employer and started doing that, and then got a little, like, you know, self-centered and greedy and only really wanted to do it to piss other people off, mm-hmm. like my old boss. And then I finally accomplished that, and it cost him a couple million in his old company, and then I was bored.
Wow.
But
so, like, I'm not sure, heavy. Was that one of the things you said you wanted to be when you...
No, I was about to ask, like, what did you want to be when you were five? Because I know what I wanted to be.
When I was a little kid, probably a race car driver, a baseball player.
Yeah.
One of the two.
I think I would say cop. Yeah, I would say cop for me when I was.
Yeah, right, I wanted to shape surfboards on the North Shore.
Oh, nice. Yeah.
Like, my whole childhood, that's all I wanted to do was shape surfboards.
It's not too late.
Yeah, you're right.
It's not too late.
You're right. I'm just waiting on the second building to go up. I might be my new Shape Shack here in Speedway, Indiana.
What? Speaking of concerts, the other we went to the other night. What's the best concert you've ever been to? Like, the most memorable? What's the best one you've ever been to? Rico and I have had a lot of fun concerts.
Man,
the Disappearing Act at the Rathskeller. There's all sorts.
I gotta tell you, like, I would probably say when I was younger, Third Eye Blind.
Oh yeah,
like, those were like 90s sensation. Like some Third Eye Blind. I went and saw Blink 182 and Green Day together once. That was the first time I got high via contact from the people next to me.
Mm.
There was plenty there. I was at that show. If it was the one here,
yes.
Or was that Deer Creek?
Deer Creek.
Oh, was it? Okay, so I went to the one
because Green Day called some kid up and was like, "Hey, can you hold this one chord? Because, you know, we only know three. If you can hold this one chord and just strum along," and he's playing Billy's guitar, and then the bass player gets some of the boom, 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 and then they get some other kid like, "Hey, can you do basic drum work? Come on up." And they had these three people from the stands playing the song.
Oh, that's cool.
Because they did the same thing.
And they gave them all the equipment. Like, you keep the guitar, you keep the bass, and you pick up your drum set later.
This is like Oprah.
You get a car.
Yeah,
it's like Ellen gets a car.
Everybody gets a diamond ring. Wow. Yeah, I mean, we're just, as far as concerts, though. I mean, okay, drop something. Oh, you're all right. But yeah, dude, I remember the time.
Don't worry, Chris, we're on air.
Yeah, we went to.
I thought it was my inhaler. Oh, I might need that thing.
Yeah,
it's all good. We'll figure it out later. We're on air. We're only live.
Yeah, there's all sorts of stuff down there.
In the words of Scott.
Hey, does anybody see that down there?
In the words of Scott Pruitt, hi to my family at home.
But no, dude, we went to a concert one time, a Social Distortion concert here in Indy. So we're pre-gaming over at the Rathskeller. And we're with a big group. I mean, we're like with Morgan and the whole
Lucas Racing bunch.
Yeah, we're with the whole group. And we're out in the back courtyard, the garden party, whatever it was.
Mm-hmm. The garden spot.
There. And you can take it from there if you want. But yeah, it was a funny day.
So we're at the Rathskeller and we're pre-gaming pretty good. And we've already done enough pre-gaming. We just didn't know it at that point. But anyhow... So we're pre-gaming some more. Well, I'm looking around. I'm like, where the hell's Buckley at? And he's gone.
Copperfield.
He's gone. Like, I mean, Houdini shit. That's mm-hmm. right. I'm like, where'd he go? Next thing you know, it's like, all right, we're bringing him up from the crowd right now. He's on stage. We're all the way at the back of this venue. He's now on stage all the way at the front.
The wanderer, just wandering. I start drinking, I start to wander. I got to get into adventures.
Dude, it was good.
It was a piano play type thing, and a guy.
That's right. I forgot.
He was tapping the ivories, and he needed somebody at the mic to recite this scene, like a narrator. Anybody in the audience want to be a narrator? I'm like, heck, I'd do it. So I walked up there stumbling, knocking over the mic. Every time I started talking, there was feedback. And this guy's like, instant regret on this guy's face. He's like, this guy is going to dive through the drum kit. He's going to dive through the piano. But I kept it civil. But yeah, they're all looking around. And next thing I know, it's, you know, I get on the mic and start rehearsing this scene or start reciting this scene. And they're like, what are you doing? And some of the people that are on the
But I can tell you this dude, as soon as he started going, was like, this is awesome, because he had him going. It was like,
That was a fun night. Then Rico and I did air guitar for about a good solid hour.
Yeah, solid hour. And then I got picked up by a cab. We didn't have Ubers then.
Yeah.
Got picked up by a cabbie, passed out in his car on the way home. Mm-hmm. I think somebody slipped me something. It could have been 25 drinks, but not really sure what
to Eric play. Church.
Yeah.
Eric Church is the best concert I've been to.
Eric Church, country guy. National recording artist.
A few years ago.
National.
A few years ago, he was launching a new tour, new album.
Yeah.
And in order to do, he had this idea. He wanted to play 6 cities in 2 days.
Six?
6 shows in 2 days. So what he did is he had his plane set up, and it would go, you know, small airport. And then he'd get into some older venues in his big city markets. And he'd get in, he'd play 4 or 5 songs. Each one had an opener, a different opener, local guy. He'd get in with just him and his guitar, and they'd play a few songs, and then he'd get out and get, boom, that's how he could do it. Now, you had to be a part of the church choir membership, $20 a year, and then you had to try and get these free tickets. It was all free. But you had to be in the membership to have it, and then you had to try and reserve one of the limited numbers. So me, my wife and I were just dating at the time. I was like, yeah, she was all in on this deal. So I'm like, all right. So we made it happen. Got 2 tickets. Next thing you know, we wander in. I've been to 8 Seconds a bunch. Think we're gonna be stuck in the back by the old choke and puke food snack shack. And sure enough, we walk up and we stand front row. And we had to get through a couple openers that were less than ideal. Then out comes Eric Church, and he rattles off a couple things. Then he goes, you know, I just realized I haven't been here since Chief, which was like 3 albums prior. He's like, and I'm sorry for that. We're staying a little bit longer tonight. And he went on, and he covered probably another 10 to 12 songs. Just him, like, people kept walking on stage, like, whispering in his ear, like, probably, hey, we got to go. I'm just hanging out with my friends.
We're sticking around.
It was, and that was good. We saw him live in Nashville too.
Saw Country Bunker once.
Yeah, they play both country and western,
both types.
Well, what? So here's something interesting. Coming back to Indy, you know, living here for 14 years, then going home, then coming back to visit. Like, it's a lot more fun to come back and visit.
Because you know you can leave.
Well, there's that, but it's just more fun to have that balance. But when I come back though, I start seeing things a little bit differently, like. You know, what would be like a good first date spot? You bring somebody out here, you move here, you start dating, and as far as things to do, you know, because there's when you, if you live in Indiana, if you move here, you're probably move here for racing or sports or something. But I'm thinking, man, what's a good first date spot in Indy? Where do you take a chick in this town?
Rallies.
Yeah, rallies on
Main
on,
Street
on Rockville Road.
I go to Main Street Speedway.
Main Street Speedway is a great spot. I think they need a couple more little hot spots there to really drive them in.
I think they're close.
But I think the hockey deal is a good place.
The hockey deal?
The hockey games.
Never been to one.
Dude, they're fun. It's a lot of energy. Are. It's loud. It's a lot of energy. And it's.
Do they let them fight yet again?
The last time we went, they fight. It's hockey. They don't let them fight.
Dude. Well, sometimes they're junior leagues and junior
divisions.
Dude,
we watched them at Lucas. I think No. We watched them at Bankers Life. And they had them, and the referees, I mean, if one guy kind of brushed the other guy, he's like, okay, hold on here. Watch out, guys. I'm like, hold on.
Well, they're for a while.
Watch this kid down.
They're for a while out. When we had the Indiana Ice, whatever they were. They turned into like a U-17.
Then that must have been what it was.
Like team.
Because the suite, we bought a whole suite for $16. So.
Well, the fuel, the Indy
fuel.
That's
about as cheap as what my suite cost me for the high school football tournament last year.
It's more than that because I was there.
I guess it wasn't my suite.
Well, the Indy Fuel is AAA.
You cost me a lot of money last year. I know exactly what you mean now.
Well, the Indy Fuel is AAA for the Blackhawks, the last time I checked.
Yeah,
so they're
so
wide
it's
open.
It's changed now with the fuel.
Yeah,
but I got to tell you, if you want to talk about, like, you know, life and how it changes, right, and how you never thought you were going to do this or that, last year my alma mater, Ben Davis, goes to the state finals. Rico knows. Rico reaches out, hey, you need any passes for tonight, whatever. Yeah, dude, that'd be great. It's sick. So here I am with 3 of my buddies. I think all but one went to Ben Davis, played football at Ben Davis. And you're talking like, you know, you've gone from being in high school and you're watching all your people that you went to high school with and they're dragging all 7 of their kids, you know, down. Oh, we're going to watch Ben Davis, kid. Get in here. You know, and all your old teachers like, oh, where are you guys sitting? We're like, oh, we got a suite.
Yeah.
And you go back to watch.
Where was this at?
At Lucas.
Oh, really? So was it football?
State football.
Yeah, it's actually really cool. I mean,
one of Rico's buddies wanted to bet with me that whoever Ben Davis was playing was going to beat him. I think it was like 47-0 at the end of the first half. Ben Davis.
Yeah, and Ben Davis only put in their college freshman kids, not their seniors.
Yeah, Ben Davis' high school football probably could have beat IU last year.
I don't know about that, but they were.
But they're feeling it now because they lost 53 starters from last year.
Oh, did they really?
And a head coach, and they just got beat by Avon game two of the year.
Dude, we went to the
Browns. They're real young, real young.
We went to Brownsburg High School football game Friday night. That was a good time.
Yeah.
There was like 3,500 people in the grandstands.
Yep.
I mean, halftime show. I mean, they had their act together.
Spirit of Brownsburg Marching Band.
Yeah. Well, here's the weird part about the marching band is that my high school, the band played, and they sit in the main grandstand. They play all game. The whole game they play.
Right.
But Brownsburg, halftime, they're done.
Really?
Shut it down. I'm like, that's really bizarre.
They go out and start partying immediately.
Yeah. Cake and ice cream.
Pancake.
Yeah. Dude, what's the wildest night of your life?
Not for this station.
I'm taking the cue cards.
The wildest night of your life.
But I will tell you this. So
Saturday night?
Yeah. Yeah. So you're talking about concerts.
Yeah.
So I worked them forever when I was a kid until, 30, late 30 something, you know. I work all these shows and One of the best shows was Page and Plant, and it would have had to been like 1993 or 4. And, you know, they were playing Zeppelin's music, which I'm a huge fan, and they had the Indianapolis Symphony Orchestra playing with them. And, I mean, it was unbelievable. It was at Market Square then. Maybe it was at Banker's Life. I can't remember, but... And the other one was Moody Blues.
Oh, nice.
Moody Blues with the Carmel Symphony Orchestra.
I like Moody Blues.
I mean, unbelievable. From pure talent, okay? And Elton John's right there, too. Yeah. I mean,
Elton John's on the list. He and Billy Joel are the two I want to see.
That dude. Well, that's one of the shows that I ran was those guys on tour together. And I mean, it was, you know, it was unbelievable, but a lot of memories out there on the road. So
I got a new cue card pulled up.
Oh, pull it.
Okay.
First job.
Ooh.
First job for me.
Like legit job. Not helping your uncle clean out the shed or not staying after hours at the Catholic church.
Yeah. I never did any of that part. So it was a real job, but I was still working for my dad, so that was a little different. But probably the first real job not working for a family member was a gas station.
Ding, okay? Ding.
And I got it exactly. And I got to tell you, so this would have been like 89, I'm guessing, somewhere in that area. And I'm out there pumping gas, and this dude pulls up. And I mean, I remember, I think gas was, I mean, it was definitely below a dollar. And I remember I was pumping gas and this guy pulls up in this vet. He pulls up to the full service lane. You know, that's when they had full service. So he's like, yeah, put 20 in it for me. This dude's cool as, you know, an attic fire. But anyhow, so he says, yeah, put 20 in it. I'm like, okay, you know, so I'm back there and, you know, like, Jesus, you know, this is a really nice car. So I got all the hose and everything and I get it over there and put it in there. And so I pump it away and I'm at 20 and I get done and grab the hose. I pull it out. It blows gas all over the deck lid of this car.
Oh, like, sorry, sir.
I'm like, oh, shit. Put the cap on. $20.
Oh, like, no.
It's like, it'll blow off or dry out, you know. But
Jesus.
But I'm telling you right now, it was like, yeah, it was the biggest fright I ever had. My first job.
I worked at a gas station too. It just reminded me of a story. I worked at a gas station too, the morning shift where people were coming in to get their morning coffee, smokes, gas, whatever. This old timer comes in. He was meter. Henry is a rattlesnake. He comes in. He goes, "Give me 20 of the good stuff." What the hell's that mean? This is a 1954. What does that mean? And he walks away. And there's a big line. So he goes out. And this is in the 90s. So he comes back in, slams the door. He goes, "Ah, damn it. I said 20 of the good stuff." And I'm like, what does that even mean? He put $20 worth of diesel in his car.
Of the good stuff.
Of the good stuff. And his car is not diesel.
That's the bad stuff.
Exit, stage left. I'm like, you don't see me. You never saw me. But anyway, my first job was probably a paper route.
Yeah.
As a kid. Yeah. Old school paper route.
This is going to blow your mind. This is why every time you want to go to lunch here, I say no.
Oh.
My first job, Union Jacks. Bus boy, 14 years old.
No way.
That's right, man.
So every time I bring up Union Jacks, you're like,
I'm like, again.
Dude, the Henny Penny, though, will make your toes curl.
A lot of Henny Less Penny.
Oh, that's right. We did go to the...
We've done the Henny Penny.
The last time I was here, I went to lunch with him. It was great. And then we had lunch.
We went for like 4 hours.
It was terrible, man. It was a 3-hour tour.
But yeah.
Dude, it was a long experience.
Bus boy at Union Jack's Pub.
Back when you could smoke in there, though, that would have been terrible.
Yeah, Gritterville. You probably took like 100 years off your life.
And there was 100 pounds of mints scattered around the furniture way at all times.
Love it. Kind of like the Texas Roadhouse where you're throwing mints everywhere instead.
Pretty much.
All right, next card. What were you like in high school?
I think it goes this way, doesn't it?
Oh, no. Okay. You were last. I'm next. All right. You go back.
All right.
I'm kidding.
I was a douche. Like, straight up, like, blonde tips, spiked hair.
That is bad. I mean, I wouldn't have taken you for that, but I like
puka
this.
Shells.
I like this.
Blonde tips.
Like zero cares. I was look, here's the deal. My parents traveled full time. I had a 3,500 square foot house across from the country club. My sister was at Arizona State racking up my dad's $40,000 bar tab. I had a basement, fully stocked bar, pinball machine.
So you were off the leash.
Backyard, hot tub, and good times lied ahead for me every single day.
That sounds like a good time,
though. Pretty much my mom came home from a trip once and slapped me across the face and said, "This isn't your damn flop house." I said, "No, I don't know what that means, but I'm still going to party, Mom."
So let me ask you this. Did your parents have a desirable car that you should not have been driving?
I feel like you know this. Yeah, so...
I'm kind of leading into it because I've heard one of these stories similar to this before.
So when... I think it was Packy, my old man, and my mom were off for the final race of the year. And I... Like, Packy had, you know, the Kiwi tile in the garage. Then underneath this perfectly put on cover was the 5 Series BMW. Like, I marked...
The car.
I marked where the tires were. I got in that thing, and we had some fun. Like, it was one of those weekends where, like, the hot tub needs to be drained.
Stuff.
Everything needs to be Lysoled.
Things have happened.
Dude, I filled up the car, reset the trip, put it right in the spot, vacuumed out the bottom, reset the seat, did everything perfectly, right? This is when they were still members up here at the old Speedway Social Club. And so we came back over there, and they used to let me drink, and we're celebrating. My dad had just won the championship, I think, with Scott Dixon. Like, life was good. And we're coming back, and my old man says, "I got to tell you, your kid, he took the car." And I'm like, "Go to hell, old man, I didn't take your car." And we're arguing in the car while my mom's driving our drunk asses home. I was still in high school. Funny enough, she had to pull over on 16th Street to let us, like, synchronize puke outside of the car. Father like son.
Hey, now.
And then I found out how I got busted.
My high school was nearly not this cool, by the way.
And here's how I got in trouble. Here's how I got busted on the whole thing. I did everything perfect. I didn't change the radio station back to his. I left it on 95.5 WFMS Country Countdown.
Oops.
Instead of Q95.
He gets in the car and he's like, "I don't listen to this shit."
Yep.
Who had this on?
Boom.
Immediately.
That was it.
All right, Buck. You're next. What was your best high school?
In high school? First of all, I was terrible in high school. I started off good because the way I worked in my area was you went first through sixth grade, seventh, eighth, then 9 through 12.
That's interesting. That's similar. Mine was 1 through 6. There was a seventh grade building, and then it was 8th and 9th, and then 10 through 12.
Yeah. So junior high was great. Played football. That was the way we were going, football and baseball and golf. Got into 9th grade, played football, golf, and tried for baseball.
Golf.
And I got kicked out. I was a terrible student. I couldn't – I just – I don't know. I hated it. I mean, the only thing that kept me there was the sports and girls. That's it. I hated school. The only thing I'd want to do is draw pictures of the beach and race cars and stuff. I eventually got kicked out of a class in ninth grade.
At least you weren't like on Super Bad when he was you know, drawing, you know what.
But every first day of school was basically, all right, we'll see you in about 5 months for summer school, right? Well, long story short, my junior year was the most fun. But I was typical. I was chubby, overweight, never had a date, never had to take my best friend's sister to the prom kind of thing. Never drank, never got stoned, nothing. I was such a late bloomer and all that. And I just liked to go to the beach and go to the racetrack. But I do remember going into my junior year, and we had this special four-class deal where all the pretty girls were at. So that actually inspired me to go, was the pretty girls. So going into my senior year, we finished summer school. The final day of summer school, the principal pulls me in. She goes, yeah, have a seat. I'm like, oh, okay, great. I'm just happy to be here. Last day of summer school. She goes, well, we have some bad news. I go, really? What's going on? She goes, we want you to know that you can't go here next year. I said, really? Why is that? She says, remember that class in ninth grade you never made up? We never made it up, so you can't go here. And you're telling me this now on the last day of summer school? I mean, if I knew that, I wouldn't have went to summer school and ruined my summer.
Right, total waste of time.
Total waste of time.
Thank you.
But, dude, I remember missing like 20-something days of school in 1 month. My dad's like, what are you doing? You're telling us you're going to school and you're not going to school? Well, I'd go over to my buddy's girlfriend's house and her friend. We'd stay the night there in high school. Just go over and stay. Her mom lived on the other opposite end of the house, and she lived on the other side, and we'd stay the night. And we'd do all sorts of fun stuff. And, yeah. But I never made it through high school. I had to go to a bad school for bad kids and never made it out of there alive. It was around the OJ trial, so mid-90s, somewhere in there. And I watched the OJ trial, and I got a job offer. I'm like, you know what? I'm out of here. See ya. So I never actually finished high school and all that. But yeah, high school wasn't very fun. It was not fun.
Thank God you've made it to this point without a high school education.
Here we are.
Or a full high school education. You've got a partial.
We have a partial with 3/4.
I don't know if you can check that on any of the boxes.
There's no check mark.
I skipped my first and 10th period every day my senior year. So 2 weeks before graduation, they said, Chris, you know, you're not going to be able to walk. That was the first year they moved Carb Day to a Friday. And graduation was Friday, so I really didn't care.
I'd have been like, perfect. I wasn't going anyhow.
Now, back then, we had so many people in my class, you only got 6 tickets for graduation. So the underground market was really strong for these tickets. So I sold them for $150 each. I took and gave all the stuff back to the people from Herf Jones, other than the coffee mug that had my name on it.
Which is definitely a keeper.
And then, you know, cap, gown, and ounce, and all that shit, just gave it all back. Got all the money back. Came home, told my mom, gave her like 60% of the cash. And then plus I kept the other 40%, plus I kept the ticket sales. And then I went and took a test, and I've got an honors diploma from the state of Indiana from the good enough degree, GED people.
Good enough degree.
Good enough degree.
Yeah, I was a terrible student. My brother and I were both. We were off the leash. We did whatever we wanted. At one point, my parents were finally like, okay, we either turn them over to the state of California and the courts, which would happen. Derek and I always fought, always had the police at the Buckley house, always had 3 or 4 you know, cop cars trying to, you know, get us back together. But yeah, dude, we were off the leash. And the parents finally realized there's nothing they can do. It's either ship us off or just let us run amok and cross our fingers and hope they turn out good. I don't know. We're still waiting for the results to come in.
Well, I got to tell you, your brother's doing a really good job in life. And Sean, we're looking forward to you joining him here soon. Yeah.
My brother, Dan, and I, we're 18 months apart. We're the youngest. We're the last 2 of 5. And let me tell you something, the first 3 absolutely ground my parents down to nothing. They were done. By the time it got to us, they were like, whatever.
Was it Mick, Steve?
Scott.
Scott, sorry. Yeah, Steve, Mick, Scott. That's Mick, right,
Steve,
that's right.
Scott, yep. Dan.
All guys, all boys.
Yeah.
So then my senior year, it says, you know, what were you like? Well, so I played football. I wrestled and I lifted. And other than that, that's the only thing that kept me getting a decent enough grade because I knew if I didn't, I couldn't, you know? So I was like, yeah, but had a lot of problem with discipline. Kind of goes back to the original report card in 4th or 5th grade. And, so anyhow, in Newcastle, I don't know if you've ever been there or not before, but they have a field house, okay? It's a 10,000 person arena for high school basketball. It's the largest in the world high school arena, right? Well, in this high school arena, it's dug in. It's down. It's not out. In this high school arena has a lot of steps. And a lot of steps means a lot of running. And a lot of running means, not good. Or when I was in wrestling, I got to mop all the mats about every day.
Oh, of course.
Anyhow, I get to it. We're right around prom, and so I dated a chick that didn't go to our school. But anyhow, I was like, I get to prom, and I'm one of the candidates for prom king. I'm like, okay, you know, whatever. And you know, I mean, they used to joke with me, a big man on campus. I mean, the thing of it is, I knew everybody. Everybody knew me. A small school, and you know, which was cool. Well, anyhow, we get to prom. I get prom king. So you guys are sitting with royalty. That's where I was at with that. But,
sorry, sir.
But anyhow.
Newcastle royalty at that.
Yeah. Yeah. Jack, stacks, you know, all the above. But anyhow, so I graduate by the grace of they wanted me out of the school, I think is how it really went down. Because they called me back. So it would have been, you know, 20 plus years later to speak at their National Honor Society thing.
Oh.
So I get on stage and I said, first of all, I said, I want to start by saying I was never allowed on this stage ever when I was here. I said, but I'm going to give you a couple numbers. I said, I want you to see if you can figure them out. If you can, $500 to whoever. I said 3.74 out of 12. And I said, 275 out of 278. I said, has anybody got any clue what that means? Nobody says anything. I said, well, my grade point average was 3.74 out of 12.
Oh, Jesus.
And in my graduating class, I was student ranked number?
275 out of 278. I said, so what I'm getting at is what you do here doesn't define you, okay? And I said, but I will say this, all of you kids in the back row back there jacking around, I was with you. That was me. So you do have a chance. You've got a chance in this world.
Don't let school get in the way of a good education.
So anyhow, it was good though, but it was cool to go back there. And I mean, I super smart kids. My brother Dan was in all that. As he always tells people, yeah, I carried my books home and Rico kicked his home.
Yeah.
I got to buy a few grammar books along the way. Thank God I was working for my dad. She's like, you owe $20 for that book you destroyed. I'm like, here's 40. Keep 20 for the next one.
Let me prepay my next visit.
I'll prepay you.
So, oh, man.
Anyhow, so, but... Appreciate you guys coming in today. Test running.
Test run.
First ever.
Systems
run.
Check.
Yep. Going to make a lot of memories in this room.
Yep. Ought to be.
Oh, yeah.
Nice, sure. Nice wheeler.
It's steady Eddie. I just like that. It's like we're here on the skinny.
That's right.
It means, you know, if you're under a 40-inch waist.
38.
You're not in.
You're out. And so have you... Have you ever seen that scene where we were talking about Rogan, how he does it with the monitor? Like they'll start talking about something and be challenging each other, like we were talking about the Vespa and the.
Oh yeah.
Next thing you know, the pictures of them are popping up.
Yep.
You know. Mm-hmm. So, but no, we've proud of what we've got here and proud of what we built, and it's taken an army to do it, but we're here and. Gonna keep on trucking and doing some more, so we may even let you use it for one of your crazinesses.
There you go.
Hey, Vato.
All right. Carl, we're out.
This episode of The Skinny has been brought to you by Fatheadz Eyewear. Check out all of our unique eyewear lines for men and women at fatheadz.com. To read more about Rico's history, his blog, and philanthropies, visit his personal page at ricoelmore.com.